To really get a glimpse into the golden days of the railroad in the American Southwest, you need to take the rail runner south to Belen, where one of Fred Harvey's famous Harvey houses has been converted to a museum and whose collection pays homage to this era of railroad history.
Right now, you are standing in the formal dining room of what was the Harvey House.
Okay.
In essence, a Harvey House was a restaurant. It was beautifully set, as you could see from this table.
Gorgeous china.
Mr. Harvey, who started this whole process, he insisted on Irish linens, crystal, English china, the works. He wanted the best for the patrons who ate on this side. Mm-hmm. They would get off the train right there off those first tracks, come in this door, entered by a maitre d'. The soup or salad, their first course, was on the table waiting for them, and they already had placed their orders on the train. And that information was telegraphed here ahead of time.
Wow.
Belen was a refueling stop for the train, and it took 30 minutes to do the refueling. So that's how long the patrons had to eat their meal, which is why it had to be a well-oiled machine.
Right.
The girls were trained very, very well in the art of serving, and they treated every customer with dignity and respect. That was a two-way street for Mr. Harvey. He felt that if any of those patrons disrespected the Harvey girls, out.
Okay.
And he meant it.
He ran a tight ship.
He did. He did. Now, he learned the restaurant business in New York when he got off the boat as an immigrant. The first help wanted sign that he saw was in a restaurant. They hired him as a dishwasher. So he learned the business from dishwasher all the way up.
And how long was the Harvey, what was the golden days of the Harvey houses?
This one in particular opened in 1910 and went until, the late 30s.
Okay, so I mean, a good chunk of time.
Yeah, it was.
Fred Harvey had a vision of creating a civilized experience in the untamed West, and successfully built a hospitality empire along the tracks of the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe Railway. But for all his imprints along the railroad, the gracious young ladies known as Harvey Girls are his most enduring legacy.
It's the original staircase that leads up to the dorm rooms upstairs. And as the Harvey Girls came in the evenings, the dorm mother's room would have been most likely this one because she had to do bed checks. The girls had to be in at 10 o'clock at night.
Okay.
So if they were not here, they had to remember which of the stairs was squeaking so you wouldn't step on that one. Now we're coming to the T intersection, and this would have was the manager's suite.
Okay.
And again, if a Harvey girl wasn't in by 10 o'clock and thought she would sidestep the dorm mother's room and come up the fire escape, well, she had to go past the manager's suite. Part of a Harvey girl's contract also was that they could travel. Harvey girls, once they worked for 6 months for the company, they could travel anywhere the Santa Fe went for free.
That's a good benefit. And what would be a typical day? Like, how many hours were they working?
A typical day would be that a Harvey girl would get up at 5 o'clock. They had to be ready for service at 6 o'clock. And then they worked three shifts. And they were asked not to wear jewelry and makeup during the days that they worked. On their one day off, they were discouraged from doing so. And the reason for that was Mr. Harvey didn't want his girls to be confused with those painted ladies. That's why we wear a nun's outfit.
Right. But there's a certain prestige that, there was an heir to the Harvey girls.
Well, Mr. Harvey did not want his girls to be called waitresses because waitress was still kind of a demeaning term. They were Harvey girls.
Fred Harvey, you gotta tip your hat to the man. After your visit to the museum, cross the street to grab a bite at Pete's Cafe. And don't miss the historic Doodlebug engine on display just around the corner from the museum.